I'm Hannah Dawson, Dr. Hannah Dawson. I teach history at the New College of the Humanities. And before I introduce Professor Cannadine, I'd like to offer a special word of welcome to those school students who are here, I believe, and I hope, who have won the Grayling Essay Prize. So congratulations and welcome to you. So it is a great thrill to welcome Professor Sir David Cannadine to speak to us today. David is the Dodge Professor of History at Princeton University and a visiting professor here, notionally here, at the New College of the Humanities. David is, without doubt, one of the most distinguished historians in the world. That is no exaggeration. And I was trying to work out how to introduce him today, and I couldn't even count, actually, the number of books that he has written. I counted at least 16. So there. And he'll also be familiar to many of you as the voice on Radio 4 when he presents A Point of View, which is one of mine and my grandmother's favourite programmes. And I mean that in you know, the best possible way. David specialises in British and American 19th and 20th century history, and his interests span empire and monarchy and aristocracy and class, and he's also very interested in the writing and in the teaching of the discipline of history. I probably am out of date now. I thought that his most recent book was The Undivided Past, History Beyond Our Differences, which was a critique of the historian's focus on conflict and polarities and a reminder of integration and sociability. And today, David is going to talk to us about Winston Churchill, Anglo-America, and the special relationship in the 20th century. Welcome, David.
Hannah, thank you so much for those immensely kind and generous words. Since I earn my living as much by talking as by writing, and since when I talk I'm normally introduced by somebody else, I have become an unrivaled connoisseur of introductions to myself, if I can put it that way. And you did, Hannah, avoid the humiliation which I experienced when I was on the road with my biography of Andrew Mellon some years ago in America. And I was lecturing in Kansas City, and the person in charge, the person who did the introduction, nothing like as generously as you've done, said, "We're hugely delighted to welcome David Cannadine. He is the author of the greatest biography of Andrew Mellon ever written." And I thought, oh, this promises well, this is coming on. He then rather spoke the effect by saying, "It is, of course, the only biography of Andrew Mellon ever written." So thank you for not saying that tonight. I want to talk about Winston Churchill, Anglo-America as defined and embodied by him, and, as it were, what the Churchillian legacy, if anything, is in our own time today. Towards the end of the 19th century, which insofar as it had belonged to any nation, had first and foremost belonged to Britain, Rudyard Kipling wrote two poems which remain essential reading for anyone interested in the Anglo-American special relationship. The first poem, published to coincide with Queen Victoria's Diamond Jubilee of 1897, was interestingly entitled Recessional. Instead of celebrating, as might have been expected, the greatness and majesty of Britain's far-flung empire with its dominion over palm and pine, and on which the sun never set, Kipling drew attention to the transience of earthly power and the ephemerality of global dominion. "Lo, all our pomp of yesterday is one with Nineveh and Tyre." A year later, he produced The White Man's Burden, a poem in a much more upbeat vein and intended for a very different audience. Addressed to the American people and sent directly to Theodore Roosevelt, who was then governor of New York and would quite soon become president, Kipling's purpose was to urge the United States to take unabashed advantage of their recent conquest of the Philippines and to assume a more self-conscious imperial role. It was, Theodore Roosevelt opined, rather poor poetry, but very good sense from an expansionist viewpoint. Well, during the course of the 20th century, the respective histories of the United Kingdom and the United States followed precisely the trajectories which Kipling had so presciently sketched out for them. The British Empire duly went into recessional mode. beginning with the independence of India in 1947 and effectively ending with the return of Hong Kong to China exactly 50 years later. Meanwhile, as the British were letting go, Uncle Sam did indeed oblige by taking up the white man's burden, thereby succeeding John Bull as the greatest power in the West and indeed as the greatest power in the world. In part through his crucial intervention in the First World War and his more sustained involvement in the Second, in part because of his increasing military might, economic strength and cultural dominance, and in part through a host of new global agencies which he financed and dominated, among them the United Nations, NATO, the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund. Thus were Kipling's poetic predictions borne out while the 20th century unfolded, as one great English-speaking power succeeded another, and without a single angry shot being exchanged between them. Yet for the Americans on the way up, this was clearly a happier century and a happier outcome than it was for the British, who, by contrast, were on the way down. There were many Britons on both the left and the right who deeply resented the ruthlessness and the completeness with which the United States superseded the United Kingdom as the great hegemon. There were others who believed that Britain's decline could be postponed and its influence sustained by holding close to the special relationship in which Britain played Greece to America's Rome, offering experienced guidance and worldly wisdom to the new global colossus and thereby perpetuating a disproportionate amount of its own influence. And then there was Winston Churchill, the Yankee Marlborough, with a British father and an American mother, whose wartime collaboration with President Roosevelt was a high point in Anglo-American amity, and who believed to the end of his life in the unity of the English-speaking peoples as the best way of preserving British influence and of promoting peace and progress in the world. But as so often with Churchill, there was also another story to tell, not so much of rhetoric and romance, but of reality and realpolitik, which casts a more nuanced light on his evolving attitudes towards the United States and on his handling of the Anglo-American alliance during his two periods of supreme power. It's often forgotten that before 1930, Churchill found many aspects of American life and of American policy distinctly uncongenial. And even during the heyday of the English-speaking Union during the Second World War, his ardent Atlanticism was never fully reciprocated in Washington. And in the 10 years after 1945, these divergences of opinion and also and increasingly of resources became ever greater. In short, Churchill's relations with America and America's relations with Churchill were much more complex and also much more interesting than the latter-day image of him as the man who in his own person embodied the union of the English-speaking peoples suggests. And I want to talk this afternoon about those ambiguities and complexities, both for their own sake and how they ought to inform and inflect, in a way that they don't, the rather tired rhetoric about the special relationship that is still trotted out on occasions today. When he first addressed a joint US session of Congress in December 1941 in the aftermath of the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor, Winston Churchill noted that if his father had been born American and his mother British instead of the other way round, he might have got there on his own and not needed the Second World War to bring him to Washington at all. Born in 1874, he grew up in a period of late 19th and early 20th century diplomatic rapprochement between Britain and America, when the rivalries and resentments of the previous 100 years were being put aside, and when the phrase English-speaking peoples, which Churchill was to make so much of, was first coming into fashion. Moreover, this rapprochement was not only diplomatic and political and cultural and linguistic, it was also social, one sign of which was the growing number of impoverished British aristocrats who sought rich American heiresses to bolster their own declining fortunes. In this activity, the Marlboroughs, Churchill's family, were preeminent, for both Churchill's father and his cousin had ensnared American heiresses, respectively Jenny Jerome and Consuela Vanderbilt. And the first time Churchill himself visited the United States, he was obliged to deny to the awaiting pressmen that he had also come there in search of a rich wife. Churchill made two early visits to America, in 1895 en route to Cuba as a war correspondent, and again in 1900 as a Boer War celebrity in search of lucrative lecture fees, who would soon be taking his seat in the British House of Commons. In general, he found the experience both educational and exhilarating. "This is a very great country, my dear Jack," he wrote to his brother. "They make you feel at home and at ease in a way that I have never before experienced." Although the grandson of a duke, Churchill was himself, of course, brought up in relative poverty. He was a self-made and self-supporting man, and there was much about the freedom and the openness and the opportunity qualities of American society which he greatly admired. So it was perhaps unsurprising that Beatrice Webb concluded on first meeting him in 1903, just after those two visits, that the Yankee strain was uppermost, and, her words, that Churchill was more the American speculator than he was the English aristocrat. Well, Churchill hoped to visit the United States again during the 1900s, but the pressure of politics prevented him. Nevertheless, he was predictably overjoyed when the United States finally came into the First World War on the Allies' side in 1917, and he made speeches up and down the country praising President Wilson and welcoming the American troops to Britain and to Europe. "So far as I can see," he observed in one of them with evident delight, "the great branch of the human family which speaks the English language and whose wide estate covers the greater portion of the habitable globe has reached complete unity of moral conception and practical aims." Not surprisingly, when the English-speaking Union was set up here in London shortly after the First World War, Churchill was one of the founding figures, and he spoke in characteristically magniloquent and high-flown terms about the permanent brotherhood and comradeship between Britain and America. Nevertheless, for all its appeal to him as a self-made man, Churchill did not entirely warm to America. For Parche Beatrice Webb, he was too much of an old-world aristocrat for that. After all, the United States had been created on the basis that all men were equal, that deference and nobility were alike unacceptable, that hereditary titles should be outlawed, and that monarchy ought to be abolished. Those were not sentiments to which Churchill was ever sympathetic. He concluded, on the basis of his first visits, that American politics were deeply corrupt, with a vulgar press, an irresponsible democracy, and excessively powerful party political machines. And he also found out that what was undeniably an English-speaking nation was in fact a much more diverse country of immigrants, and as such was full of substantial pockets of vociferous hostility to Britain and its empire. This was especially true of the Irish and the Dutch, and he encountered serious hostility and heckling from them on his lecture tour in 1900. Those criticisms of American society and politics in no sense lessened Churchill's gratitude for American military help during the First World War, but they inevitably qualified it. And as a national and imperial patriot, Churchill was also not altogether happy about this sudden assertion of American military might, which could threaten Britain's global preeminence, even as it had recently helped to preserve it. Moreover, as a firm believer in what he regarded as the stable, ordered, layered European society, characterized by forms and ceremonies, institutions and symbols and traditions, he did not in fact warm to President Woodrow Wilson, the self-styled champion of democracy, morality and self-determination, and the enemy of tradition, of monarchy and of empire. Indeed, by the 1920s, as is plain in the volumes of The World Crisis in which President Wilson appears, Churchill had become deeply hostile to what he regarded as Woodrow Wilson's intolerant idealism. And it was, of course, that same naive, overbearing, and as Churchill saw it, bigoted utopianism, which was responsible, in his view, for another American evil, which to Churchill was scarcely less dreadful and almost completely incomprehensible, namely prohibition. What was it possible to think of a nation that had outlawed the consumption of alcohol? in the late 1920s, pursuing this theme of not altogether approving of some aspects of American society and legislation, Churchill invited a group of Mormons down to Chartwell for lunch. The Mormons attacked the sparkling water and the orange juice with enormous vigour. Churchill attacked the brandy and the champagne with equal zeal and enthusiasm. And in the course of the lunch, the senior Mormon turned to his host and said, "Mr. Churchill, the reason I do not consume alcohol is because it combines the kick of the antelope with the bite of the viper." Churchill turned and fixed the chief Mormon with his most wickedly beatific smile and replied, "All my life I have been searching for a drink like that." Well, these deeper concerns of an old world conservative for what he saw as misguided new world zealotry and abstemiousness were reinforced for Churchill by the international politics of the 1920s. During that decade, there were only two effectively functioning great powers. Britain, whose empire in the aftermath of the First World War was now larger than it had ever been, and the United States, which had suddenly appeared and indeed erupted as a new force on the world scene. They had been allies, but now they were sliding precipitously from friendship to rivalry, as an ever more arrogant and domineering America seemed to be challenging Britain for world supremacy. Churchill did not like that and dug his heels in. Indeed, so intransigent was Churchill that in 1927 he went on record in the British Cabinet, where he was Chancellor of the Exchequer, as saying that the United States was fundamentally hostile to Britain and that war between the two nations was far from being unthinkable. If the Conservatives had won the general election of 1929, Churchill had hopes of being moved from the Exchequer to the Foreign Office. But his wife Clementine considered this unlikely, and her explanation is very revealing. "I'm afraid," she remarked, "your known hostility to America would stand in the way." Well, in the end, of course, the Conservatives were defeated at the general election of 1929, and Churchill began for what would be for him a decade out of power, so the problem and the issue never did arise. But it's worth pointing out, I think, that no one peering into the future would at that date, 1929, Churchill's lived well over half his life by then, have predicted that he would soon emerge as the self-styled champion of Anglo-American amity and English-speaking unity. How and why, then, did this very significant change in his worldview occur? In 1929 and in 1931-2, freed from the cares and burdens of office, Churchill paid two lengthy visits to the United States. The first, it's important to notice, in almost three decades. And they transformed his views of the country. For the first time, Churchill journeyed beyond the Mississippi to the West Coast. And as a result, he obtained a much more vivid sense of the vastness and abundance and potentiality of the United States. Even in the Depression, he was impressed by the scale and sophistication of American industrial production. And he noted that unlike Britain, the most able men went into business rather than into politics. All this may help explain why he became convinced that the United States, as the richest and most productive nation in the world, would and must and should become the prime impetus to economic recovery in the aftermath of the Wall Street crash and the Great Recession, and that Britain should join forces with the United States in that endeavour. Only by joint action, by the English-speaking people, Churchill said in one of his lectures on these tours, can we hope for a revival of the wealth of nations, by establishing stable values and by regulating the commercial traffic of the world. Well, as this suggests, the most lasting and significant consequence of these two visits to the United States was that Churchill abandoned his earlier hostility and became an ardent enthusiast for and an eloquent advocate of the cause of Anglo-American unity. One result of which was that he now set out to provide an account of what he called the common past of Anglo-America in a multi-volume history of the English-speaking peoples. Those books were not finally published until Churchill was in retirement in the late 1950s, but he wrote most of them during the late 1930s, and they vividly demonstrate how his thoughts had evolved since those two trips to the United States in 1929 and 31-2. As Churchill had now come to see it, the English-speaking peoples meant essentially the United Kingdom of the United States. No other bit of the British Empire really got a look in. And according to this interpretation, their shared history unfolded along a predestined path to the great democracies with outstanding events along the way. Magna Carta, the Bill of Rights, and the Declaration of Independence, which on this somewhat idiosyncratic reading was not so much a manifesto for the separation of the United Kingdom and the United States, but a defining document which would eventually become their joint heritage. As Churchill saw it, this majestic edifice of Anglo-American friendship was built around the growth of freedom and individual rights under the law. Of these ideas, he told his research assistant, Maurice Ashley, in April 1939, note the date, of these ideas, the English-speaking peoples were the authors, then the trustees, and must now soon again become the armed champions. Thus was already sketched out the strategy he would seek to pursue during the Second World War. Yet across the 1930s, this was not a cause which aroused much enthusiasm on either side of the Atlantic. In the United States, Franklin Roosevelt's main concerns were domestic, and he was advocating a period of bold and continuous experimentation, reinforced by a visceral hostility to the established Republican, financial, banking, business order, which found little favour in British official circles. And insofar as FDR gave much attention to Britain, he embraced a kind of Wilsonian dislike of its monarchy and its empire, and he thought that the British were simultaneously too wealthy and too weak-willed. For their part, on this side of the Atlantic, the British were convinced that the Americans harboured predatory ambitions regarding their empire, and that their leaders simply could not be trusted. That was Stanley Baldwin's view, and it was also Neville Chamberlain's view, which helps explain why he rejected Franklin Roosevelt's admittedly ill-thought-out peace initiative to deal with Europe so contemptuously in early 1938. Nor, despite his vigorous espousal of the cause of Anglo-American amity, was Winston Churchill wholly happy with the way things were developing in the United States. It's important to remember that by the 1930s, he was in the most conservative phase of his political career, a die-hard imperialist reactionary, whereas FDR was at his most radical, and Churchill was publicly critical of the New Deal, especially what seemed to be its irresponsible determination to run a budget deficit and its strident attacks on big business and the old social order. And Churchill was also deeply concerned about American isolationism and regretted the country's continued hostility to the British Empire. So despite the developments of Churchill's own views, there was nothing predestined about the Anglo-American alliance as it eventually evolved in the course of the Second World War. Official opinion in Britain did not regard the United States as a dependable ally, and official and public opinion in America had no wish to be involved in another European conflict, and least of all in another European conflict to preserve the British Empire. Indeed, from this perspective, Churchill's call for an Anglo-American alliance was not, as he saw it, the highest expression of the preordained unity of the English-speaking peoples. On the contrary, it was neither a relevant policy nor a realistic proposal. Of course, when war broke out and Churchill returned to his old position as First Lord of the Admiralty, which he'd occupied in 1914, as well as now again in 1939, he did indeed begin to correspond with Roosevelt. But they were not personally acquainted. They'd only met once, and Churchill didn't even remember that they had. It was the president who took the initiative, and during the early months their exchange of letters was desultory in the extreme. Only when Churchill became Prime Minister in May 1940 did their correspondence move into a higher gear. For with Hitler triumphant in so much of Europe, Churchill was clear from the very beginning of his government that the only way Britain could win the war, as distinct from possibly surviving it, was to draw America into the conflict. And even when Russia became Britain's co-belligerent in June 1941, that opinion and that strategy still held good. Accordingly, in the first 18 months of his premiership, 1940 and on into 1941, Churchill did everything he could, publicly and privately, to woo, captivate and cajole Roosevelt. "I mean to drag America in," is what he said at that time. Hence the constant transatlantic allusions in his speeches, as in the peroration to his Finest Hour speech, where he held out the possibility that the whole world, including the United States, would sink into the abyss of a new dark age if Hitler vanquished Britain. Hence his lavish praise of Roosevelt in his world broadcast, this great man, this thrice chosen head of a nation of 130 million people. Hence his burgeoning and carefully crafted correspondence with FDR. "Mr. President, the one decisive counterweight I can see to Hitler were if the United States were immediately to range herself with us as a belligerent power." And after a slow and hesitant start, it began to work. As Anglo-American cooperation drew ever closer late in 1940 and on into 1941. The destroyers for bases deal, lend-lease, the visits of Hopkins and Harriman to England, the first meeting of Churchill and Roosevelt off Newfoundland, and the subsequent signing of the Atlantic Charter. All this must mean, Churchill delightedly told the House of Commons, that Britain and America were now being mixed up together in some of their affairs for mutual and general benefit. It was a process, he believed, that could not and should not be stopped. Like the Mississippi, it just keeps rolling along. Let it roll on, full flood, inexorable, irresistible, benignant to broader lands and better days. Well, to the British Prime Minister, as he told King George VI, this meant that Britain and America were now walking out together, and that their eventual union could not be long delayed. But this was easier said than done. At the personal level, Churchill and Roosevelt knew very little of each other when they first met at Newfoundland. And although they came to admire each other, they were also always distinctly wary of each other. Roosevelt thought Churchill was a Victorian Tory and reactionary imperialist, while Churchill regretted Roosevelt sometimes showed signs of Woodrow Wilson's naive and intolerant idealism. When Churchill became Prime Minister, FDR's main concern was to try to establish whether he was sober enough to do the job. And each time the British gained help from the Americans, it came on very tough terms. The destroyers for bases deal obliged Churchill, much to his regret, to give the Americans a blank check on the whole of our transatlantic possessions. Lend-lease was a lifeline, but it also meant the British were obliged to part with their gold reserves held in South Africa. Roosevelt simply dispatched an American destroyer to take them away. And the Atlantic Charter, with its call for all peoples to live under governments of their own choosing, was a classic formulation of idealistic American anti-colonialism, and thus was a direct threat to the survival of the British Empire. Nevertheless, the next phase of the war, from December 1941 to September 1943, marked the high point of the Anglo-American alliance and of the Churchill-Roosevelt relationship. Immediately after Pearl Harbor, Churchill rushed to Washington and delivered a triumphant address to Congress, where he spelt out, among other things, the importance of Anglo-American amity, and he expressed his regret that the two nations had been so far apart for so many of the interwar years. The President and the Prime Minister spent a great deal of time together and clearly relished each other's company. "It is fun," FDR later telegraphed Churchill, "being in the same decade with you." Since at this stage the British had been and still were doing most of the fighting, Churchill was able to persuade the Americans to accept his vision of grand strategy, namely that the defeat of Germany should take priority over the defeat of Japan, and that in Europe the initial Allied effort should be in the Mediterranean rather than on the Atlantic coast. And when Churchill returned to the United States in the early autumn of 1943, his hopes for the deepening and perpetuation of the Anglo-American alliance were high. On receiving, at Roosevelt's prompting, an honorary degree at Harvard University, he urged that the temporary Anglo-American alliance might become the foundation of a common citizenship. "I like to think," Churchill went on, of Britons and Americans moving freely over each other's wide estate with hardly a sense of being foreigners to one another. But while all this, for Churchill's powerful rhetorical and historical imagination, was the working out of his most cherished hopes for transatlantic cooperation and collaboration, this was not the whole picture, and it was certainly not how Roosevelt saw things. For there were not only disagreements about strategy within the Grand Alliance itself, the relative strengths of its members began to shift, and this was not to Britain's advantage vis-à-vis the United States. In Europe, the Americans increasingly tired of what they soon came to see as the British obsession with the Mediterranean and began demanding the opening of a second front on the North Atlantic coast of France. In Asia, the fall of Singapore was a bitter imperial humiliation for Britain, and thereafter, the Allied war effort in the Pacific was largely, not entirely, but largely carried on by the Americans rather than the British. Moreover, for his part, Roosevelt became convinced that he should have direct dealings with Stalin and thought Churchill, with his long record of strident anti-Bolshevism, was more of a hindrance than a help as an intermediary between the two men. And the American pressure on the British to advance their empire towards self-government continued unrelentingly. So when Churchill made his ringing declaration at a speech here in London in 1943, "I have not become the King's First Minister in order to preside over the liquidation of the British Empire," those defiant comments were intended as much for Washington and Moscow as they were for Tokyo and Berlin. Well, from the autumn of 1943, the balance of power between Britain and America within the Grand Alliance swung ever more towards the United States, in terms of military might as well as economic resources. This irreversible change made it much harder for Churchill to get his way, part cause and part consequence of which was that his relations with Roosevelt deteriorated significantly. At the Tehran conference, FDR deliberately distanced himself from Churchill and set out single-handedly to charm and court Stalin instead. Throughout 1944, there were constant disagreements between the British and the Americans over Italy, over Greece, over the invasion of the French Mediterranean coast. Thereafter, Churchill was sometimes, but not always, more sceptical of Stalin than Roosevelt was. But at Yalta, he once again found himself sidelined with, as he saw it, the two leaders ganging up against him and against the British Empire. And while on Roosevelt's death, Churchill paid him a Periclean tribute in the House of Commons, "the greatest champion of freedom we have ever known, whoever brought help and comfort from the New World to the Old," he decided at the last minute against attending his funeral in Washington, a sure sign of how far their personal friendship had cooled, and a great missed opportunity for getting to know the new president, Harry Truman. Well, what was the balance sheet then? It is important not to lose sight of the fact that despite those disagreements, the Grand Alliance did defeat the Axis powers, that Anglo-American collaboration was the closest component of that alliance, and that Churchill had been proven right in his basic initial assumption that the British might survive alone, but they could not win without the active military involvement of the United States. The result in some ways, as Isaiah Berlin wrote wonderfully in his essay Winston Churchill in 1940, was in many ways a great partnership in a great cause led by two undeniably great men, even if it did not always operate in the blaze of friendship that Churchill liked publicly to claim. And it's also certainly true that vis-à-vis the Americans, though rather less so vis-à-vis the Russians, Churchill played what was always a weak hand astonishingly well. The Americans may have disapproved of Churchill's Mediterranean obsession as they saw it, but not only did Churchill get back all of the Eastern Mediterranean empire that Britain controlled, Egypt, the Sudan, Jordan, Mesopotamia, that's to say Iraq and Palestine, it obtained an increased sphere of influence in Libya, in Greece, and in Turkey. And, of course, in the Pacific, Churchill did succeed in getting the Americans once again to defend the British Empire, to pull the imperial chestnuts out of the fire, because it was the Americans who really won back the British Empire in the East, in Hong Kong, in Singapore, in Malaya, and in parts of India for Britain itself. The difficulty and disappointment for Churchill was that as in 1917 to 18, but even more so in 1941 to 45, the Anglo-American relationship was intrinsically and increasingly asymmetrical, and that far from embodying or portending the eventual union of the English-speaking peoples on the basis of their shared language and law and culture and history, as Churchill thought ought to happen and was happening, it became instead the means whereby the United States effectively superseded the United Kingdom as the preeminent power in the West. A.J.P. Taylor rightly, if rather wickedly, called the Second World War the War of British Succession. Who is going to succeed Britain as the world's greatest power? And the answer, of course, was the United States. So when in his final review of the war in the House of Commons in the summer of 1945, Churchill described the United States as being at the summit of the world, whereas Britain's power and influence, by contrast, were diminishing and declining. This was cause not only for rejoicing, but also for regret. Not for nothing would he later label the last volume of his war memoirs Triumph and Tragedy. Roosevelt's death in April 1945, and Churchill's defeat in the general election 3 months later, brought to an end a personal friendship and a political association, which, if it hadn't always met up to Churchill's highest expectations of Anglo-American union, had certainly brought the two nations closer together than at any time since 1919. But as soon as the war was over, the United States cancelled Lend-Lease, the terms of the subsequent American loan were severe, and the true extent of Britain's economic and international weakness soon became apparent. The British economy was close to bankruptcy in the late 1940s. The pound was devalued. India became independent, or as Churchill saw it, the Indian Empire was given away. The Palestine Mandate was given up, and Britain abandoned its position in Greece and Turkey that Churchill had only recently won for it. All this sudden dramatic decline in Britain's international standing and perception of its economic resources and its relationship with America caused Churchill enormous dismay, because the things he had fought the Second World War for seemed to be falling apart. Whatever may be said to the contrary, he lamented in the House of Commons, "Our relations with the United States have definitely become more distant and more difficult. America," he told Clark Clifford early in 1946, "has now become the hope of the world. Britain has had its day. If I were to be born again, I'd want to be born not a Briton, but an American." Nevertheless, although he was now in opposition, Churchill made two significant contributions to Anglo-American relations in the immediate post-war years. The first was the speech which he delivered at the invitation of President Truman at Fulton, Missouri, in March 1946. In it, Churchill ranged widely over the contemporary international scene and set out to accomplish two particular yet also interconnected objectives. First, he sought to alert the United States to the threat which communist Russia presented to freedom and democracy, now that an Iron Curtain, one of the phrases that's launched around the world in that speech, had descended across the continent of Europe, and to enlist America's support against Stalin, as he had previously sought its aid against Hitler, another tyranny that has to be faced down. Second, Churchill insisted that his country, despite the troubles it was going through, was still a force to be reckoned with, and he reiterated the need for the continued fraternal association between the two great English-speaking peoples, between whom there was, and here's another phrase that has had a very long life, a special relationship which might lead to common citizenship. Together, Churchill argued, Britain and America could impose their order on the world, and in their continued and intensified collaboration, harking back to what he'd been saying since the 1930s, lay the best, indeed the only, hope for the future. Churchill claimed on that occasion that he was speaking as a private citizen. In fact, and despite their subsequent disclaimers, he delivered his speech with the prior knowledge and approval of both President Truman in America and of Prime Minister Clement Attlee here in Britain. And in so doing, he sought to make a case for shifts in policy towards Soviet Russia, towards a hardening of policy, which both governments were already contemplating but were not yet publicly prepared to signal. The result was, at the time, it did indeed seem as though Churchill's words, very soon after, brought about a fundamental change in American foreign policy, which soon became much more robust towards Soviet Russia and correspondingly more sympathetic towards the continued existence of the British Empire, which it now seemed more important for America to support as a means of containing communism than for America to help dismantle as an imperialistic and anachronistic abuse. All this meant that for Churchill himself, the Iron Curtain speech was a triumph and a tonic in the aftermath of the devastating defeat in the general election of less than a year before. He appeared to re-emerge not as yesterday's man, but as a world statesman with important things to say about the present and about the future. And this in turn gave him the confidence to begin and the framework within which to set his account of the Second World War, which was his second contribution to Anglo-American thought and relations during this period. Buoyed up by the impact of his Fulton speech, Churchill started serious work on his memoirs as soon as he returned to Britain. He had many reasons for wishing to write his memoirs: to make money, to tell an extraordinary story as only he could do, and to give his version of events. History, Churchill observed on one occasion, will not be kind to Neville Chamberlain. I know, because I'm going to write it. But he was also concerned, and this was in some senses his most fundamental public and strategically driven imperative, he was also concerned in the course of those books to demonstrate the continued and fundamental importance of the Anglo-American alliance. Accordingly, in his first volume, he placed altogether excessive stress on Roosevelt's ill-fated and ill-thought-out peace initiative of early 1938, claiming that if only the British had been cozier with Roosevelt and listened to him, the war could have been stopped at that point. In the second volume, he exaggerated his close relationship with Roosevelt, and in describing Lend-Lease as the most unselfish and unsordid financial act of any country in history, he made no mention of the widespread official opposition to America's harsh terms, an opposition which in some senses he himself shared. Thereafter, in the later volumes, he consequently sought to minimise his frequent and growing and deep disagreements with the President and also with Eisenhower. I have, he told Eisenhower, apropos of the sixth volume, taken great pains to ensure that it contains nothing which might imply that there was in those days any controversy or lack of confidence between us, which of course there often was. Moreover, on those occasions when he was obliged to admit the British and the Americans did see things differently, Churchill suggested it was because he was wiser and more worldly than they were, that he was right and they were wrong. Accordingly, when it came to the closing months of the war, the Yalta Conference and so on, Churchill insisted, rather implausibly, that he had all along divined Stalin's true and malevolent intentions, but that Roosevelt was by then too ill to do so by himself and was too trusting and naive to take his one true friend's advice. From this perspective, Churchill's History of the Second World War, an extraordinary influential set of books, by the way, still influential today. From this perspective, Churchill's History of the Second World War set out to show that the Anglo-American alliance was essential to the peace and progress of the world, and that it worked best when the Americans accepted the guidance which the British were uniquely equipped to provide, and when they sought to support the British Empire rather than undermine it. This, according to Churchill, is what the history of the Second World War showed. By the time the last two volumes were published, Churchill was back in Downing Street, and that was precisely the policy he intended once more to adapt. For his aim, initially with Truman and subsequently with Eisenhower, was to recreate the old wartime collaboration in all its individual and by now highly nostalgic intimacy. In part because he believed that the Americans would want to benefit from his accumulated wisdom and experience. in part because he hoped to persuade them of the continuing greatness of Britain and its empire, and of their vital necessity to the strength and future of the United States. In part because such a renewed association might yet be a prelude to the more thoroughgoing union of the English-speaking peoples, after which he had been hankering since the 1930s. And in part because there might be a chance for him to broker a deal between the Americans and the Russians at the very highest level, a deal which the recent invention of the hydrogen bomb made ever more urgent, necessary, and compelling. Churchill, in short, was sure when he returned to 10 Downing Street in 1951 that, given time to talk over a few family matters, as he called them, the Americans would take things from him that they would take from no one else. The problem was that neither President Truman nor President Eisenhower was remotely interested in doing so, and John Foster Dulles, who became Eisenhower's Secretary of State, was even less enamoured and enthusiastic. Fond as they were of Churchill for what he had been and what he had done, and much as they cherished their earlier wartime associations with him, both presidents were convinced that his greatest days were over and that he was living too much in the past. And so, although Churchill made three visits to America during his second peacetime premiership, his high hopes went completely and utterly unrealised. It was impossible to conceal the fact that he was a diminished man and that Britain was a diminished nation, and that the so-called special relationship mattered much more to the United Kingdom than it did to the United States. Neither president shared Churchill's view that most of the world's problems could be solved by reviving the Anglo-American wartime partnership, and Eisenhower was distinctly unencouraging when Churchill volunteered to initiate discussions with the Russians. If America and Russia wanted to talk, they didn't need Churchill to broker the deal. If they weren't willing to talk, there was nothing Churchill could do about it. "When I came to America before," Churchill admitted to Lord Moran at the outset of one of his last visits, "it was as an equal. They have become so great and we are now so small. Poor England." Yet even at the very end of his premiership, in his final words to his cabinet colleagues, he continued to insist that Britain must never be separated from the Americans. Well, the rest of this story is easily told, and I think it carries with it some implications for, as it were, what has happened since. Churchill's retirement was followed by the Eden Premiership and the Suez debacle, which temporarily sundered what was left of the Anglo-American alliance and set absolutely at naught Churchill's valedictory advice. He brought to belated completion his History of the English-Speaking Peoples, which he had laid aside in 1940, and which ended at the close of the 19th century, when Britain and America were to become allies in terrible but victorious wars, and which might themselves be the prelude to the ultimate union, the hope with which the book ended. And when Churchill paid his last visit to the White House in 1959, at the personal invitation of President Eisenhower, he again dwelt on the themes of the continuing greatness of Britain, the importance of the Anglo-American alliance, and the unity of the English-speaking peoples. It was his last transatlantic hurrah. Nevertheless, there was a final flourish which was revealing in more ways than one. In April 1963, and by Act of Congress, President Kennedy proclaimed Sir Winston Churchill to be an honorary citizen of the United States, thereby recognizing his outstanding achievements as a leader in war and peace and his steadfast loyalty to the American nation and people. This sunset salute by the country he delighted to call the Great Republic gave Churchill particular pleasure and satisfaction. "I have," he observed in his acceptance speech, which was read for him at the White House by his son Randolph, "received many kindnesses from the United States of America, but the honour which you now accord me is without parallel. In this century of storm and tragedy," he concluded, "I contemplate with high satisfaction the constant factor of the interwoven and upward progress of our peoples." "Mr. President," he concluded, "your action illuminates the theme of the unity of the English-speaking peoples, to which I have devoted a large part of my life." But even in those last 10 years of sunset and apotheosis, the ambiguities of Churchill's in some ways ardent Anglo-Americanism persisted, and they were hinted at in another section of the speech, which was very different in tone and substance from the majority of his appropriately gracious and appreciative remarks. For he was, he noted, the former Prime Minister of a great sovereign state, and he deliberately emphasised those robust attributes of national stature and historic independence in order, I quote, to reject the view that Britain and the Commonwealth should now be relegated to a minor role in the world. In thus reasserting Britain's claims to be taken seriously as a great power, Churchill was explicitly rebutting the remarks made by Dean Acheson at West Point several months before, when the former United States Secretary of State had opined that Great Britain had lost an empire and not yet found a role in the world. The Kennedy administration had taken pains to distance itself from Acheson's comments, but they caused a furore here in Britain, not so much because they were insulting, but rather because they were true. Nevertheless, as Britain declined and Churchill's life ebbed slowly away, his own popular reputation in America went from strength to strength, and his death was front page news across the country. His great state funeral here in London was in many ways a quintessentially Anglo-American occasion, with Eisenhower present as a personal guest of the family and with the battle hymn of the American Republic being sung at his service in St. Paul's Cathedral. But as with the ceremony granting Churchill American citizenship, there was a discordant note, for the official American representation at the funeral was disappointingly meagre. Lyndon Johnson was unable to attend because he was unwell. He was unwilling to send Vice President Humphrey in his stead, and Dean Rusk, the Secretary of State, who did fly to London, had to pull out at the last minute because he caught flu. There were some who thought this was belated American retaliation for Churchill's refusal to attend Roosevelt's funeral exactly 20 years before. In fact, there was no such conspiracy. Two unlucky illnesses and a serious misjudgment by Johnson were all it took. But he was much criticised by Anglophile America as a result. And thereafter, Hubert Humphrey was dispatched so often to overseas funerals that he became America's full-time mourner-in-chief. Well, that glitch on a day of grandeur does serve to remind us that in life as in death, Churchill's relations with America were a characteristic and complex combination of grandiloquence and grittiness, rhetoric and realism, hope and disappointment. In his years of maturity and greatness, he did come to believe passionately in the shared historic destinies of the English-speaking peoples. He relished his collaboration with Roosevelt as an elevated encounter between great men and kindred spirits, and as a fitting prelude to that much-desired eventual outcome of union. And after 1945, he still pursued the special relationship as the means whereby Britain might influence America and America might support Britain and its empire. Yet for all that, Churchill was always aware that a very thin line divided Anglo-American amity from Anglo-American rivalry. And for the first 50-odd years of his life, he was at least as suspicious of the United States as he was captivated by it, and those suspicions were, with very good reason, never wholly allayed, even between 1940 and 1945. In the Second World War, he saw the American alliance as the essential means whereby Hitler might be defeated and British greatness safeguarded. But while he achieved the first of those objectives triumphantly and did all he could to bring about the second, he soon came to realise that America and Russia would be the leading post-war powers, with Britain a much diminished nation, and that there was nothing he could do to prevent this. And although, after 1945, he took every opportunity to urge and celebrate the union of the English-speaking peoples, in his heart of hearts, he knew the great cause as he had defined it and championed it was lost. We passed all the tests, but it was useless, he said, late in life. And here was another of his late life sentences. I have achieved so much to have achieved in the end nothing. By which he meant that the safeguarding of British greatness and the empire, the task to which he had devoted his public life, in the end, he'd failed. Well, it is then scarcely surprising that Churchill's Anglo-American legacy is an appropriately, and I think a hugely interestingly, ambiguous one. In the United States, the Churchill cult continues to thrive, and he is dutifully quoted by American leaders more frequently than any other figure. And in Britain, subsequent prime ministers have sought to follow Churchill to the White House, where they believe their greater energy and or superior wisdom carries a wholly and rightly disproportionate weight with the incumbent president. Thus, Macmillan with Eisenhower and Kennedy, Thatcher with Reagan and Blair with Bush, all sought to recreate in some form or other that greatest of all alliances allegedly embodied in the partnership of Churchill and Roosevelt. Yet there are others who denounce this transatlantic Churchill cult from being based on nothing except snobbery and condescension in the United States and delusion and nostalgia here in the United Kingdom. From this perspective, American veneration for Churchill is but one more sign that they see Britain as a quaint, class-bound, past-it society, an anachronistic amalgam of Masterpiece Theatre, Downton Abbey and Ruritania. While a succession of British prime ministers have wielded far less influence in Washington than they ever claimed to do, beginning in fact with Churchill himself, and that their time would have been better spent pursuing Britain's true future destiny in Europe rather than indulging in transatlantic fantasies of continued global greatness, which were already out of date in 1955, and perhaps even 10 years before that. These are no doubt excessively oversimplified and over-dichotomized versions of post-Churchill Anglo-American relations with which we are still living to this day. But it cannot be denied that the transatlantic connection since then has not always been a happy or a harmonious one. It took the British a long time to recover from what they saw as America's betrayal and perfidy at the time of Suez, while there were serious Anglo-American tensions because of East Coast funding of the Irish Republican Army. And Ronald Reagan sent the troops into the British colony of Grenada without even deigning to consult the Prime Minister, even though Grenada was a British colony and part of the Commonwealth. Nor have such irritations been wholly confined to the British side. All too often after 1945, the Americans yet again have been called upon to assume at short notice great power burdens which the British could no longer afford to discharge, as in Greece and Turkey in the late 1940s. Lyndon Johnson never forgave Harold Wilson for refusing to send British troops to fight alongside the Americans in Vietnam. And there were many people in the Reagan administration who were strongly opposed to the covert help which Caspar Weinberger gave to the British during the Falklands War, and Reagan only came down on the British side at the 11th hour and the 59th minute and the 59th second. Now, of course, it can be argued that, like any marriage, the special relationship has had its inevitable share of ups and downs. But unlike most modern marriages, the Anglo-American alliance has been intrinsically asymmetrical since about 1944, and it has become more and more asymmetrical year by year since then. As America's global role has expanded while Britain's has diminished, the allure of continued transatlantic camaraderie has been much greater here in London than it is over there in Washington. Since the Second World War, the State Department has rarely used the word special relationship and has constantly urged that Britain should integrate itself more closely with continental Europe instead of hankering after privileged and outdated transatlantic treatment. And only occasionally have American presidents sought British support, not because of its military significance, which actually doesn't really count, nor out of any particular fondness for the special relationship, but rather as a cover for what might otherwise appear unacceptably unilateralist American action. That was why Lyndon Johnson requested British troops for Vietnam, and why both Bushes wanted British troops in Iraq. Harold Wilson said no, and he was right. Tony Blair said yes, and I have to say, in part, I think, intoxicated by the allure of Churchill's own account of the American special relationship, Tony Blair said yes, but I have to say, I think he was wrong. And we are still living with the consequences of that terrible error of judgment, based in turn, I think, on a complete misunderstanding of the complicated historical realities of the Anglo-American special relationship that I've tried to talk about tonight. Thank you.